Hello, Nana here. Welcome back to Grim Dawn. We're playing with the Drain Essence Death Knight on Hardcore Ultimate Difficulty, and today we're gonna go for the Altar of Ratosh and a look at Ulgrim in the Void. Before that though, I made some gear changes and I wanna quickly go over those. The old gear is here. I ended up replacing my belt with +1 to soldier skills with this new Court of Violent Decay. I think this is the one that dropped last episode somewhere in between all the other stuff that dropped. +2 to Drain Essence, +2 to Hungering Reach. We're already capped on Drain Essence. We were at 12 out of 12 on Hungering Reach, and I decided, well, that is actually enough for now. I don't really care too much about pushing this beyond 12, because the returns for this specific build, the way I'm playing it, are minimal, and the energy drain will just end up going up. Yeah, there's a small chance of affecting multiple targets. Yes, the crit damage goes up a little bit. Yes, you do get 1% extra attack damage converted to health, but we're already getting enough from gear that the returns are marginal and I value the skill points more. The old one gave +1 to all skills in soldier, so we're no longer getting a bonus in soldier skills. So what I did, I refunded 2 points here because we are already 10 over the limit, and that is the max. You can never go more than 26 out of 16. This one, I refunded it back down to 12 out of 12, and then I spent the extra 4 points putting one more into Warcry, capping it. Same for Overguard, Field Command, and then the last one went into Menhir's Will, getting it back to 6 out of 6, so we get a 40% health restore the way we had before. So we did lose a little bit of military conditioning, that cost me some life and some physique. Shield training, so that's a percentage point of block chance, and just bomb pointers and all the other things. So we did lose some power across the line, notably of course fighting spirit, some offensive and damage abilities there. But we now have a belt that gives us a bonus to vitality and ether damage, 70 points of offensive ability, and we also get pierce resistance, and we get poison and acid resistance. So in terms of resistance, as we gained a lot, we gained some offensive ability, and there is a lot of damage in there. So this belt, I think it does more for us than simply trying to cling to this +1 to soldier skills just because it gives a +1 to soldier skills. And this one gave vitality resistance, which right now we're still 100 points over capped, so we're never gonna need more of that. So we gained a lot from the belt. Also switched shoulder pads. These have less armor than the previous one. Previous one had 1586. Nice health bonus, good elemental resist and bleeding resistance bonus. Damage was not useful here. Bleeding, we were overcapped, so bleeding wasn't doing too much. Elemental resist, most of them were overcapped. Lightning is still 52% overcapped. So again, that was not doing too much. So then you're left with the armor bonus and the health bonus. At the time when I equipped it, it was helpful. Right now, we've moved a little bit beyond it. So instead, we now have these. Most notably, the insight. 5% chance on attack to get the insight bonus. For 8 seconds, you get 10 energy regenerated per second, which it will again be scaled by all your bonuses to energy regeneration. Right now, I get 96 energy per second. When this kicks in, it goes up to 45. So we gain about 50 points of effective energy regeneration per second for 8 seconds from inside, which is pretty good for helping sustain energy. During my warm-up, I didn't need to drink a single energy flask. So we'll see how that goes. In addition, this one gives more offensive ability. It gives spirit, which gives energy regen, and it gives damage, pierce, fire, and chaos resistance. So all of this combined, I gained a lot of resistances, which meant I could shuffle some of the augments and components around. And in the end, I could dedicate a little bit more towards some utility and some damage bonuses. So there's now an ectoplasm in the metal, for example, 20% more energy and +2 to energy regen. The +2 to energy regen translates to 10 energy regen in practice. So I went from 85 to 96, which was pretty darn helpful. And I did lose some health. I mean, that's 6% health on air, won't appear from nothing. So I shifted some components around, and for example, now we have a Ravage's Harvest in our shield, which gives 250 health in addition to Vitality and Vitality Decay and Damage. And here we have Basilisk's Bite, which is nearly the same. There's health in here, there's stun reduction, and there is some fatality damage. And this is still poison based. But yeah, basically, I'm just shifting things around. Oh, there's a spell Scorched Plating in the belt now, because I no longer needed the antidote. So there's health on there, there's armor on there, and there's elemental resistance on there. So overall, just overhauling things a little bit, and now the old gear
Got
can
something
go.
you need
So
stashed?
we'll put this one
It's safe with
in the
me.
stash for
Promise.
decomposition or stashing at some point. And now let's dive in. We need to go back to the Barrow Holm waypoint and then go into the void. And try and see if we can pick a fight with Ulgrim. Sometimes it works, sometimes it does not work. I hope we can pick a fight, because it would be interesting at least to pick a fight with Ulgrim today. Let's see, is he still the most challenging enemy? No, he's not. Reshelga so far is the most challenging. One of the bosses of the Hidden Path. But I suspect Ulgrim will be topping that list for quite a while if we do manage to make it past him. So, Altruggetorsh is pretty easy to find. You just go up this path and then you stick to the left-hand side. And at some point, you step into the portal. Hello, an Ember Claw and Reflective. Okay, I can deal with that. And as you can see, energy much fuller than normal. Haven't drank a single energy potion yet. These are both 107, so 7 levels above me. And lots and lots and lots of components are dropping. And more stuff's dropping. So I did enable the green items again, just to compensate a little bit for all the money I spent crafting components and doing gear upgrades and things like that. It's no during the longer episodes where I'm overflowing there, where it is really useful to just disable the green item drops. It would be nice if monster infrequent items actually had a special rarity in between green and blue. Maybe if they were like green with a special colored border or something. Something heroic popped in. You are vampiric. Okay. But that with the loot filter, you could say, well, regular green items, I don't care, but monster infrequent green items, I do care. Because they are usually, they have a special modifier that you can't get from any random greens. So those are, they're nearly blue items in that regard. I suspect that would solve a lot of issues with, oh no, I'm getting too many loot items type of problems. Some of the monster infrequent green items, they're no as built a finding as a blue or a purple item would be. Okay, we insert frying pan, we get a portal to the void. And now we are in the waste. So how is our chthonic hate? 5,500 reputation still required before we can get some nemesis spawns from the chthonics. So chances of one of those appearing anytime soon are pretty slim. So those Bloodkeepers are healers. That's something to account for. Oh, one of the multiple side effects. Oh, something is porting in here. You are a charger and you are a
My skill's not
usurper.
ready.
Usurper, of course, means nothing specifically, so you could be anything. But one of the side effects of making these gear swaps is A, my energy is more stable. B, I lost a little bit of armor. C, I gained some damage. And the damage gain is, of course, helpful. Because the more damage I do, the more life I leech, then the faster enemies die. And if enemies die faster, they're alive for a shorter time, so they have less opportunity to deal damage to me, which translates into more safety. No, that's no part of the theory. If you're playing a glass cannon, if your damage is high enough, then not having any defenses doesn't matter, because enemies are not alive long enough to actually try and deal damage to you. So in that way, no, it is a very effective way of tanking. Downside is, if you leave enemies alive long enough, then okay, that did not look like something normal. Is there a hero in the back? Or is that a kind of attack I simply haven't noticed before? Apparently that's a kind of attack I haven't noticed before. But yeah, no, a glass cannon kind of falls if the enemies manage to actually do damage to you. So that's where having defenses comes in, rather helpful. But boosting your offense in a leech build, it works two ways, so you can wiggle a little bit with that. And I think sacrificing a little bit of armor, gaining a decent chunk of offensive ability, and just broad damage. I mean, we're now listed at 12.3k damage, and that's listed damage. Doesn't account for all the resistance debuffing that we're doing. I think that's doing decently. So something teleported over to the left and I haven't seen it come back yet. Tip the scales, has reached maximum rank. Lovely. Ah, okay, so two healers and a tank. That's good. If they were not in the fight, I'm not worried too much over that. Also, why the heck are they just scurrying around, not really trying to kill me? Okay. Weird demons. Or Ktonians. So, a little bit of a secret here. Oh, hello. How are you, healer? Oh, it's a servitor. It's not even a blood thing. It's just a regular servitor. And it's just effectively a very small shortcut past a treasure storage. I do like treasure storages. Doomed remains. And then we go back up. And now we get a spawn behind us, and they are not fast enough. So first we'll have to defeat the Diablo lookalike Balrog demon thing. Honestly, don't know its name. Most of the Ktonians, they've got names that are very difficult to remember. Just lots of odd names and sounds. Just brain finds it difficult to latch onto those. Oh, also keep in mind, this is effectively a challenge area. Things are 5 to 6 levels above me. Boss is probably going to be even stronger than that. Also, while we are close to the boss fight, there is a little bit of a secret that is, of course, useful to go, and that is at the top here. Smash the stone, go in, and then there are hidden spoils and bomb piles and more things. I'm getting some green items. That's the boss room down there. But sometimes you do get a little bit more lucky. So I do try to keep my reaping spirit out as often as I can. It is a nice little distraction. Even if enemies just pay a little bit of attention to it instead of me, if they just slow down a little bit while they're approaching me, I got a good opportunity to just touch them with Drain Essence, or more likely have Drain Essence just touch them automatically because it just scatters all over the place. Affect them with a debuff. Ooh, hello, electrified. Affect them with a debuff, and then no, they already have some time to just tick down on their health, so they approach me a little bit more weakened than they otherwise would be, if they even manage to make it to me. But part of the value of having a small pet is not really in the damage that it does, it's also just in the distraction that it provides. Oh, it's effectively another soft layer of defense. Okay, boss time o'clock. We'll just loot this while you drop out of the sky, and it's 109. So this one has the habit of just doing some ground effects, making things fall and shake and quake. Okay, let's just try and not stand too much in the same space. Also, just keep shouting at it a little. Okay, I was a little nervous there. Just drinking a health flask. Okay, let's find a better space to run. Just drain some more life. Shout at you a little, reduce your damage. I mean, it does try to sunder my armor from the looks of it. Just put Overguard up here. Turtle shell kicked in. That's definitely not a good thing. Or it's a good thing that it kicked in. It's not a good thing that it had to kick in. Get away from the volcanoes. Shout at you a little again. Nope, reducing its damage by a quarter. Very much a fan. Is Overguard still up? No, it's not quite up anymore, is it? Okay, shout at you again. Rip your spirit out. Drain you some more. Ah, dash that one. And look at that. Gone it is. An end to the darkness. So I'm trying to keep Overguard up as one layer of defenses, but it's only up for 10 seconds, and after that, no, it's going to be down for another 10 seconds. In that time window, you can use Mark of Torment, because it does have 40% damage absorption in my case. So that will carry you for another 4 seconds, only leaving you vulnerable for about about 6 seconds. So if you time it just right, so when you're under heavy attack, maybe it helps a little. So now we get to the intermediary bits, walking towards Ulgrim, and Ulgrim is going to be the real fight here. Now keep in mind, the demon we just fought, he puts up a fight. He really does put up a fight. And with other characters, I've actually just ran through here multiple times trying to farm up reputation with Barrowholm, because Barrowholm really likes it when you kill Ketonians. So, well, this being just around the corner, it's kind of a convenient place to just farm for killing Ketonians. Actually, we probably gained quite some Ketonian hate rep as well. It's only 300 points. Need to kill more Ketonians. But I think at some point I farmed it like 5 times over. I did die once in the fight. The boss, it is a dangerous boss, so do be careful and wary of it. Don't underestimate the fight. I suspect the damage shield we have here probably helped a little bit as well. Okay, Ulgrim, let's see if we can provoke him.
Is that you, mother? I'm sorry, but I'm afraid.
Snap out of it, man.
As you command, my emperor, your son lives. I made certain of it. He is safe in a secure location.
You're in trouble.
She and I go way back. Way back.
What happened to you?
An unfortunate accident.
Snap out of it. Okay, so that goes in circles.
I made certain of it.
What happened to you?
An unfortunate accident, my emperor. I'm afraid my left... Ah, trouble. She and I... The void.
Yes, ha! Managed to provoke the attack.
Are you an agent of Kathan here?
Let's hope I'm not gonna regret this one.
You know I'm...
Okay. Okay, so he's a Nightblade. He summons shadows. He does some reflecting stuff in all the particle effects that is difficult to see. I'm just trying to keep my Overguard out away as long as possible. Okay, so now he's reflecting, so it's not a good time to attack him, but it is a good time to attack his buddies, the Living Shadows. Well, it's effectively the Living Shadows are gonna murderize themselves. There's just too much passive damage going on here. Rip your spirit out. Okay, his health pool is impressive. And he's hardly moving. Okay, he's blade dancing again. I mean, during that time he's got 100% damage absorption and he's regenerating, if that's exactly the same as the player skill. Okay, but so the damage coming in, I mean, I can drain it. It's no fine. It's no problem. We have enough sustain here that it's not an issue. Though he does seem to be regenerating quite some life himself. Okay, this could take a while. I mean, if they don't have the damage to take me out, but if Ulgrim has enough sustain. Oh, note to self. He's regenerating health during this time. I did apply Siphon Souls just before he started doing that. I should keep that in mind. Whenever he starts doing his spin to win attack, I should Siphon Souls to just shut down his life regen. But it does require paying good attention to, yeah, this. So Siphon Souls shuts down most of his health regen. Ought to. Maybe. Yeah, this could take a while. Yep. Again, the timing here was accidentally all right. Just applying the Siphon Souls just before he did the spin to win. Okay, the damage here is spiking a little bit, so let's overguard here. Too bad that his buddies are behind me. Okay, Siphon Souls again. I'll just keep chaining Siphon Souls. Looks like it's good enough. But yeah, this fight, it's not as dangerous as on lower difficulties, apparently. We do have the capacity to just sustain right through this one. Question is, do we have the patience? That war cry up. Okay, blitzing not doing much. Maybe I should actually just tag some of your buddies. Let's do a mark of torment to just reflect a little bit of damage. It's not helping all that much. I mean, Ulgrim as boss will have reflect reduction, but if they're trying to murder me, oh, all the little bits do add up, and in a fight like this it feels like all the little bits will most definitely be helpful. Okay, spinning, so I'm soul siphoning. Good thing is we don't need to kill him, we only need to get him to half of his health. It is satisfying though, now seeing just a whole bunch of shadow clones attack me and not really caring too much about it. If we had the Siphon Souls pants, then of course that would automatically proc and reduce part of his life regen, giving us some passive sustains there. Actually I did forget to apply the bonus health. I can still drink that. It gives us another 1,000 extra health, which is helpful. I don't have the honey potion that gives you some extra health regen on a hotkey, so we'll just skip out on that one. Okay, spin into winning. I just applied Siphon Souls, so that was okay. But this fight is more an exercise in patience rather than true skill. Which to a certain degree is a little sad. Oh, Siphon Souls. Let's see, how much does the Siphon Souls reduce? 65%, okay. So it doesn't even totally stop it, it just reduces it by quite a bit. There's a weapon that has, I think it's a hammer, one-handed hammer or scepter type thing. Also gives +1 to necro skills, if I remember correctly, at least one of the higher tier versions of it. And what I think the proc of that one actually gives a -100% health regen to enemies rather than only the 65%. And of course, because it is on a weapon proc, it will just keep triggering and triggering and triggering, and effectively you're totally shutting down health regen. In this particular fight, that might actually be more important than Siphon Souls, because then it just keeps it up and you don't really need to try and time it. Okay, murder all the clones. Okay, siphon your soul. Are we there yet?
That skill's not ready.
But that is the biggest downside of fighting an enemy that has very strong sustains. You need to break the sustains. And no, you either do that by shutting down the sustain, or you do it by just increasing your damage output enough that it doesn't really matter. And with this many add-ons, it's also difficult, at least it feels like it's difficult to just get the resistance debuffs to stick properly as well. Because there's just so many add-ons that are just drawing them to them. So this is just going to be a very long, long fight. Just keep shouting at least to reduce their damage. Warcry, it does have a side effect of breaking enemies' skills. It has an interrupt component because I took the break morale upgrade for it. Okay, there's a lot of enemies. Let's just overguard here a little bit. It's also nearly impossible to see what's happening here thanks to all the particle effects and the reaping spirits. I did do the war cry and he stopped using his skill afterwards, but I think it's just a coincidence rather than an actual interrupt. Need to try and time that one a little bit better. Okay. Let's see, Siphon Souls. Rip the spirit out. Siphon Souls, it ticks up for 9 seconds, so effectively if you just keep repeating it, it should just remain up. I just realized. Because the cooldown is about 5 seconds or so. And of course the extra damage of that one is good. Also notice I haven't used a single energy flask. In this particular fight I'm totally energy stable. Probably a large part of that is because Tip the Scales will get triggered a lot here because there's so many melee enemies causing energy leech. Then there is the inside bonus that just keeps ticking and ticking and ticking. And that is all happy and good. Yeah, let's put the Mark of Torments up as well, just to reflect some extra damage. Not a lot. But oh boy, is this a drawn out fight. Makes me have a little bit of a flashback back towards the Logorian fight with my commando. That was also a fight that took 20 plus minutes. Though there, it wasn't just a matter of just being an immortal tank standing in front of an enemy, slowly grinding through it, but it was more a matter of just playing almost like being in a pinball machine, just bouncing around the arena, just getting in for little pinpricks and then getting the heck out again, just trying to distract the add-ons, waiting for all the cooldowns to reset, and then going back in for a little bit more damage. That was definitely a build that was much less able to sustain itself for a longer time, whereas this build, Drain Essence, is godly. I must say, Blade Barrier on Ulgrim is also pretty godly. Slowly, very, very, very slowly, we are grinding through this one. But it is interesting to see that I was actually rather nervous for this fight. Turns out, don't have to be all that nervous, I just have to be very persistent. So, yeah, lesson learned. This build does decent damage, no 12k listed damage. There's a bunch of resistance debuffs, there are some additional skills that will stack damage on top of that. So effective damage output, probably much higher than that 12k. But for a fight like this, you need even more damage. Or you need a good way to just totally shut down the recovery, so it is even easier to just push through. Haven't actually checked Grimtools to see what the resistance profile is of Ulgrim, because it is possible that Ulgrim is just very resistant to both Aether and Vitality damage, in which case, no, he's like a perfect combo to this build. Very possible. I haven't checked that one. But I would not be surprised when he is... Though he's going into the Void, dealing with the Cotonium, so Vitality resistance would not be too surprised. It's also some kind of special super soldier, half demigod thing. So maybe Aether resistance is not too weird for him either. In which case, well, if he's doing like 70-80% resistance to both of our elemental types, yeah, then it's going to be difficult to actually apply damage to him. Because, well, even although I am trying to stack as many resistance debuffs as I can, there is a limit to just how many I can stack. I mean, I think I'm getting 20%, 15 to 20% from the Will of Ratosh, the devotion thing. We are getting from a Band of the Eternal Haunt, I think it's 14 or 15%. And then 35% or so from Spectral Wrath. But Spectral Wrath is both Aether and Vitality, and the other ones are either Vitality or Aether, so maybe in total, if I'm lucky and all the things align, I can strip 50% resist from an enemy. So yeah, if he is incredibly resistant, he's not gonna go into the negatives on those resists. Kill all the add-ons. Well, slowly, ever so slowly, he is going down. I think I saw his health bar move another pixel. It's a good opportunity to, you know, just reflect back on the build, back on your life. It's almost like meditating. There's a certain amount of a zen to a fight like this. If it's it's not challenging, it's just a grind. It gives you some time to think, to talk. Because you're just mostly doing it on autopilot instead of really being in the fight, which is a danger in itself. If he were to do something totally unexpected and have my health bar just spike down, might not be the most responsive to that. So maybe that is his secret strategy after all. Just lull you into a sense of complacency, of autopiloting, and then boom, he's going to just hit you in the face. So yeah, the shouting at him to break it, to interrupt him, nah, that's not working. I think it's more for channel skills, things like that.
That skill's not ready.
Or maybe he's just totally immune to that. That is of course possible as well. He is a boss, right? So bosses have all kinds of special protections. It's also too bad that the shadows keep stealing the circle.
That skill's not ready.
I mean, the sigil of consumption, it is extra damage, it is extra sustain, but it's mostly the damage would be nice on Ulgrim. Whereas the other things, they can just die by spectral wrath, that's perfectly fine with me. Because their damage output, it's not significant enough, which is funny. I'll have to see if a future build, if the listed damage for the tooltip damage, right now it's 12k. Maybe for a future build, aiming for something closer to 20k tooltip at this stage in the game would be a bit better. Though having even more would of course be even better. But it is something to keep in mind for the next theory craft, so just some numbers to aim for. Though I suspect that this build is just using a random collection of, well, mostly purple gear by this point, though there's still some blues in there. Not even everything is mythical. Even got some green items in there still. So it's just a random collection of stuff I found. There's no full sets in there. Full sets, they do give you quite some nice bonuses. So there's still more power that could be added to the build. But this is by no means, but this for someone who just plays through the game and just uses whatever they find, no, more of a self-found style build or an untwinked build. This is really realistic build to just get. And that also reflects that the damage for this is pretty decent and is realistic amount of damage. Rather than just going into Grim Tools, just putting together a build with perfect sets, a full Urbrook set or something like that, yes, then your theoretical damage is going to be very high. But in practice, you're not going to achieve it because you don't have the components for it. And as I said before, I'm not someone who really enjoys grinding a lot. So I like playing through the campaign. I like doing some of the challenge things just once. And after that, I'm yearning to play a new character. Rather than doing the same dungeon 100 times over just to find that one perfect set. So aiming to have a random gathering of gear that's what you want to have a build built around that can function with that. So then more of the power needs to just come from the skills rather than special stuff that comes from the sets. Now, of course, if you manage to do collect a full set, then you can build around it. That's the other way of looking at it. Okay, are they now doing more damage than they were before? Because I actually saw my health bar move there. That's really, really odd behavior. Yeah, see, we've been at least here for 10 minutes, maybe even 15 minutes. Still going strong. Let's see, where would his health be at half? Somewhere in the human, would it be below the A, below the N? I think we need to get the health bar somewhere below the A in human. Okay, let's just do some reflecting stuff. If he's got minions that are attacking me, then they might as well just do some reflect damage back at him. Kiaman, we're getting there. Oh no, he's regaining health. Stop doing that. You bugger. So now his listed health might be something in the 2 million range. I think I've seen some of the nemesis have in the 2 million range health for this stage in the game. So his listed health might be in that range. His effective health much higher thanks to all the regen he's doing. And stretching this fight into 10-15 minutes definitely means you're churning through millions of health points, maybe 10 million rather than just the 2 or so that is listed. Oi, stop trying to actually kill me. No, just been standing here quietly, patiently, not appreciating all the hate here. No cookie for effort, maybe? No? Enemies. Can't rely on them being fair. Oh yeah, my personal health bonus also wore off, of course. Let's drink another flask. Get my health bonus up a little bit again.
That skill's not ready.
From a boss mechanics point of view, it would actually be helpful if spawning those minions would cost Orgrim health in some sort, in some way. Well, on the other hand, though, him having this health regen, it is a mechanic that you just have to learn how to deal with. Siphon Souls is pretty good for that. It's a better alternative than just doing a lot of damage to him. Something just occurs to me. If I'm attacking him with a health regenerate, with a life leeching attack, and he's reflecting damage, would I actually be healing him in that state? Could it be that I've actually been empowering him all that time? That would be that would not be a very productive way to deal with the fight, would it? That's if I see him doing his blade barrier skill. Let's just try and stop attacking. I mean, I can sustain through it. That works pretty fine. Let's get the debuffs up on everybody. Siphon Souls. Shout at everybody a little. Not liking the damage and then just not doing anything. So his health is not really going up. I mean, I'm not someone who pours over the monster database on Grim Tools and just learns all the the skills that monsters use by heart. It's every once in a while, if there's a boss that is particularly annoying, I might just have a check to see, okay, what exactly are they doing? Most often, it's actually after I do a fight like this, I go in mostly blind. And then, viewers in the comments point out, yeah, you know, the boss was doing this particular thing. It would have been helpful to maybe avoid it or something, or deal with it in a more productive way. That's usually how I learn. But yeah, other than that, mostly I just discover stuff as I encounter them. And based on that, you get a imperfect view of exactly how a fight works. And it's mostly based on observations, flawed as they might be. Okay, he is really nearly there. Health is nearly at the A of human. Come on. So close. So close. Haha! He's down. Ugh, hallelujah.
My head. I yield, friend. I yield. I remember you now.
I'll take 12.
I see.
Hallelujah. So, that was probably a 20-minute fight. Took a little longer than I had anticipated. But oh boy, was that guy tanky. So having to wrap up the last bit of the void afterwards always feels a little bit anticlimactic. It's like, yeah, I defeated the boss. So now I've got to kill a lot of Muppets. But then again, well, we're in the middle of the void. I mean, if we were totally at the edge and we could just walk out, then no, from a realism perspective, it, okay. From a realism perspective, it might not have been the greatest. Okay, I saw Arcane. I'm definitely buggering the hell out of there. So this is the true end boss of the game. Arcane Demon. Okay, oops. That's not a good place to be. Come on, please don't hit me. So this is why I like having Blitz on a build like this. Because you can use it to just aim at a straggler and just anchor your way out of a fight rather than into a fight. You can also get yourself into trouble, but getting yourself out of trouble sometimes is much, much, much more helpful. I've lost sight of exactly where the arcane demon is. There's a good chance I'm actually just losing the demon because I'm too far away from the spawn location, which is perfectly fine as well. Just dragging some enemies along, killing them, and knowing exactly now what to expect. So I can also make sure to just clear out the preceding rooms. Okay, you know what? Yeah. Shouted you. Shouted you too a little. That's good. Only dragged in half the group. And these are just regular yellows. Yeah, so that's the arcane thing. That means I got some time now to just try and murderize you. You see, the timer is a good 20 or so seconds. Okay, just getting out of there for now. Ooh, actually judged that one really well. It's more luck than skill. But the demon is gone. That is good. So yeah, arcanes. I hate them. I hate them. But the feeling is mutual. So in that regard, it's all good. And then, for now, we're just gonna stick to the left-hand wall, head up, And at some point we have to bend a little bit to the right. And then there we are. So this was just a random arcane spawn, not a guaranteed spawn if I estimated it correctly. This one actually had arcane in the name. Oh, that usually is a hint that they're not trying to just bushwhack you with an unexpected arcane. Or with an, yeah. Then it's an unexpected arcane, but no, it's like the Loxmere guy in the Fields of Strife, Plains of Strife. Place of Strife.
Can't do that yet.
Nope, that one has a name and it's always there. So that's one of those things, yeah, you just gotta learn it. This is just a surprise. But at least they're honest about it. So if you are perceptive, you will catch it. If not, well, too bad for you. Okay, before we head into the portal, there is a little bit of a secret thing here that is easy to find. It's the big snake mouth. It's actually a secret. As usually there's a treasure chest waiting for you at the end. And there's a hidden trove here, so that's good. And we got some stuff. Sometimes better, sometimes not so good. But it is secrets, and I like secrets. And this gets us out. And there is Ulgrim. Gotta keep on moving. And we get, Plunderer's Talisman. I already got that one. So that is not very helpful. But we managed to make it out alive into a Lone Watch. Ooh. One thing to keep in mind, if you are shuffling gear around and you're in the Melmoth expansion content, chances are you're going to use Coven's Refuge as the town to go to. No, because you have access to your stash, there's a vendor to sell stuff. So this is a very logical place to fiddle with some gear. There's no blacksmith, so chances are if you need to craft components, you're going to head out to one of the other cities. But you are under the effect of the Coven Ward if you restore it, I think. The problem is the Coven Ward will grant you resistances, it will increase your maximum cold resistance, it's gonna grant you extra ether resistance. In short, it is gonna mess with your view of what your resistances really are. So if you're doing some heavy duty augment and component reshuffling in order to balance out your resistances, please, please, please don't do it in Coven's Refuge. Do it in Homestead or in Devil's Crossing or some other place which don't grant you a buff and therefore they don't mess with your resistances. Because otherwise it might be that you end up perfectly balancing things according to the way your resists are in town, and then you head out of town and suddenly your resistances drop and you might be at 60 or 70 ether resistance or cold resistance or what have you, because you actually get 30 points of it. And then of course enemies are totally gonna tear you apart because suddenly you're taking effectively double the damage. So that's just a little public service announcement. I think I've said it before, but it is important enough that it does bear more repeating. I understand from a flavor perspective that it is good to grant those wards, but from a practical perspective I really wish the devs would just take it out, because it just gives you there's no point to it at this point in the game. If your resistances are not maxed, then there's something wrong with your build, because you're just taking too much damage and you really need to fix it. Therefore, the ward serves no purpose. And if it was just ornamental, or maybe if it just granted you a damage bonus, I mean, it's always good to have more damage, perfectly fine with that. If you're near town, do more damage, fine. But please don't mess with the resists, because that's just potentially dangerous. Potentially very, very dangerous. But that said, I've been going on for way too long. We did manage to take out Ulgrim. We did some gear upgrading and I'm happy with all of that. So for now, I'm going to thank you very much for watching and hope to see you again next time when we head closer towards Melmoth. Bye bye.